Cars powered by electricity were being developed as early as the 1820s, but by 1914, gas power became affordable. In the early 1990s, legislative initiatives, improved batteries, and accessible methods of recharging made electric vehicles more marketable. Charging stations provide electricity to customers with electric vehicles. It's simply a matter of swiping an access card across the reader, waiting for the station to communicate with a cloud-based server to verify the customer's account, and then plugging the charging station connector into the vehicle. The charging station provides electricity to the charger in the vehicle. It can take 1 to 6 hours before it's fully recharged. The blinking light stops. Charging is underway. A laser cutter automatically slices through oxidized aluminum sheets. In a matter of minutes, the pre-programmed cuts are complete. A worker carefully removes the cut pieces of aluminum. Unused pieces will be recycled. Another worker bends the aluminum on a bending post. He places the aluminum piece in a bending machine. Then he positions the bent piece in a pre-programmed robotic welding machine. It automatically and quickly welds the pieces of aluminum together. The worker polishes the welded joints using a soft cloth to make certain they're smooth to the touch. Polishing away rough edges makes the finished faceplate safe for use by customers. A worker assembles the painted faceplate and the head of the charging station. He screws the faceplate to the head and attaches the user interface protection, which is made of tempered glass. He places a flexible strip of light-emitting diodes around the perimeter of the light diffuser. Different colored lights tell the customer whether the station is available and whether vehicle charging is underway. He then places the protector cap containing the light strip and the antenna on the head of the charging station. Next, he connects the various components housed in the head of the charging station, including circuit boards, the antenna connection, digital display, and card reader. He inserts the control circuit board, which has the central processing unit, the antenna interface, digital display, and card reader on the other side. He uses a flat cable to connect the 40 small connectors of the control printed circuit board to the power printed circuit board, which he inserts into the head of the charging station on top of the control printed circuit board. He finishes attaching the quick connectors. A worker seals the edges of the charging station head with rubber stripping to protect the components inside from the elements outside. He positions the aluminum backplate on the charging station head, and once that's in place, he attaches the charging cable assembly to the connector module. The worker slips the charging cable wires into the frame of the connector module and securely tightens them. Then he positions the connector module door against the frame that holds it in place. He attaches them securely to each other and, using quick connect connectors, he attaches part of the plug that links the charging station to the vehicle. To make sure everything is working properly, the worker tests the door sensor and the door locking system. His test confirms the sensor is functioning and the door locks correctly. He now attaches the connector module to the head of the charging station. Then he places the head of the charging station onto its pedestal base. Whether it's being removed or attached to a vehicle, one safety feature is that the connector is never energized when being handled by a customer. Once the charge is complete, the vehicle's ready to roll. Grappa is an Italian brandy, traditionally an after-dinner drink. It's made from pomace, what's left of grapes after they've been pressed to make wine. Distilleries ferment the pomace to convert the sugars into alcohol, then distill it to transform the alcohol and other compounds into grappa. You can't make grappa without someone first making wine, because winemaking leftovers are the sole ingredient. In Italy, the wine harvest begins in late summer or early fall, depending on the weather and region of the country. The harvested grapes go directly from the vineyard to the winery. There, the first machine pulls them off the stalks, which are later composted into fertilizer for farms and nurseries. The destalked grapes enter a cylindrical press, which crushes them against the walls with an airbag-like device to extract the juice and pulp for making wine. What's left behind in the press, once the juice and pulp drain out, are the skins, seeds, some residual juice, and pulp. This is called pomace. The winery sells it to distilleries that produce grappa. This small artisanal distillery produces premium quality grappa by using only pomace from grapes pressed that very same day. The pomace goes into temperature-controlled fermentation tanks as soon as it arrives. Large industrial distilleries operate differently, typically warehousing pomace prior to processing, sometimes for months. This delay produces high levels of potentially toxic methanol, which the distillery then has to remove using an additional procedure. The distillers monitor pH and alcohol levels to determine when the conversion of sugars to alcohol is complete. The process takes from 3 days to a week, depending on the variety of grape and other factors such as the outdoor temperature. When the pomace is ready, they transfer it to wood-clad copper stills. They heat the stills with steam, bringing the pomace to the boiling point, which transforms the alcohol and other compounds into steam. This alcoholic steam inside the still rises to the top and exits through a side hole, traveling through copper pipes and other equipment, ultimately to a condensation system which cools the steam back to liquid. This liquid is grappa. As it exits distillation, the master distiller meticulously monitors the temperature and alcohol level. She discards the initial and final flows, capturing only the perfectly pure mid-flow, referred to as the heart of the grappa. Over time, both the grappa and the wooden barrels exchange compounds, which influence taste, aroma, and color. For example, a barrel made of cherry wood will produce different characteristics than one made of oak. The distillery's experts analyze and taste samples following distillation and throughout the aging period, which can be just 1 year to more than 20 years, depending on the variety. Whether the grappa is aged or not, prior to bottling, they filter and dilute it with demineralized water, lowering the alcohol content from an average of 77% after distillation to the target level of 41 to 50%. They seal the bottles with stoppers made of food-safe synthetic materials, rather than traditional corks, because a natural cork contains certain organic compounds which can, over time, alter the flavor, aroma, and color of the grappa. They seal the stopper with shrink wrap plastic. An unbroken seal assures the buyer that the bottle has not been previously opened. Then the bottles pass through a labeling station. The grappa is ready to be poured as an after-dinner drink or enjoyed on its own. As the Italians say, salute.